Fala Juventude, esse é mais um vídeo do canal Economicamente. Hoje nós recebemos aqui uma presença ilustre, professor Kumbhakar, ele que é um dos maiores especialistas do mundo em eficiência e produtividade. Se você está interessado, acompanhe com a gente. Pessoal, professor Subal Kumbhakar, ele que é professor da Universidade de Nova York, da State University of New York, ele vai hoje bater um papo com a gente sobre alguns pontos relacionados à eficiência e produtividade. Provavelmente você que faz economia já deve ter se deparado com o livro do professor Kumbhakar. Então, Kumbhakar, thank you very much to accept this interview. And now we talk about some topics about economics. And my first question is, what's the difference between productivity and efficiency?
Okay, so these two concepts are related. Some people think that productivity is the same thing as efficiency or inefficiency. So again, in the standard neoclassical approach, if you have taken any microeconomics courses, you will won't see much of inefficiency. So the productivity is, let's say, output per unit of labor. So when we talk about inefficiency, we just say that, well, the productivity that you have, for example, productivity of workers in Brazil. So just think in terms of some numbers. Then we ask, okay, can the productivity be increased without doing much? No further capital, no change in technology and things like that. So if you say that, yes, the productivity can be increased, then we say that, well, okay, that means they are not producing as much as they could do. That means they are inefficient, right? So then again, inefficiency, again, may be a component of productivity. So we can decompose productivity into various parts, and one part of that is going to be inefficiency.
And what is technical change?
Okay, so the technical change is, we talk about a technological relationship, and technical change is the shift in the function. That means with the same amount of inputs, you can produce more. If that happens, then we say that, well, there is a technical progress. And that's the same as technical change.
Okay. My question now is, how I can measure the efficiency of a company, for example?
Okay. So this is basically what I do most of the time. That means we need data, right? So instead of looking at one particular company, it can be like a particular firm, it can be manufacturing firm or agriculture. You can look at sugarcane farmers or again like beans or some other things. So we look at a sample of more than one. So I was talking to Alex, and he said, well, he has a sample of 1,000 farmers. So then we can look at the sample of 1,000 and use that information to estimate the relationship. And then again, if your objective is to focus on one particular company, we can do that. But we don't look at one particular company's data and estimate it. We usually estimate the relationship using a lot more farmers. And then you can focus on one if you want to.
Considering the methodologies to estimation the efficiency, we have two ways. For example, mm-hmm. Stochastic frontier analysis, like you use this and is the best reference in the academy. And another way is data envelopment analysis, DEA. What is the advantages or disadvantage in both methodologies?
Mm-hmm. So again, the idea is to estimate efficiency or inefficiency using both approaches. So these are basically two paths leading to the same goal. And then the goal is to estimate efficiency. So in DEA, or data envelopment analysis, the way this is done is through what we call programming approaches. So programming approaches meaning that, well, you use linear programming. So that means you formulate the problem as a linear program, and then again, if you are in operation research or your engineering field, you can easily say, well, okay, I learned this tool in my courses, so this is easy for me. Okay, in stochastic frontier, what we do is we estimate again, our objective is to get the same idea, that means estimate efficiency or inefficiency, but we use econometric approaches, right? So you have to know econometrics to use the stochastic frontier, okay? So then again, it's kind of difficult to say that which one is easier. It depends on who you ask. If you ask me, I would say that, well, stochastic frontier is easier to do it because I have been doing it all my life, right? But if you talk to someone else who does DEA, and again, like, you'll say the word DEA is easy.
Well, Professor, if I read, for example, a paper analyzing some sector in Brazil using a set of data, for example, using a methodology A, but in the conclusion of this paper, for example, is they reject the new hypothesis. But if I read the same people, the same paper, sorry, considering another methodology, they have conclusion different. Why this occur?
Okay, so two things. Okay. So the difference is, again, as I said, well, paths are different, right? So you can get some different results, but we always say that it should not be very much different. If the results are very much different, then again, you can say that, well, there must be something wrong somewhere, right? One approach may be ignoring certain things, and then the other approach is not, okay? So in the end, we always say that, well, since the difference is in the path, the goal is the same, and the data is the same, so you should be, you know, like getting more or less similar result, okay? Now, you also say that, okay, there is a way to test. Okay, that's where the strength of such stochastic frontier is, because it's an econometric, and in econometrics, we always say that, okay, you don't have to believe in certain things, okay? So there is always a mechanism to test. So we always start with something, and if somebody says, well, I don't believe it, you say, okay, hang on for a few minutes. Okay, just after doing it, you say, okay, now you say that, well, your null hypothesis is that, okay, there is no inefficiency, we can test it. But if you are doing DEA, you cannot have a null hypothesis that there is no inefficiency, because the whole technique is to estimate inefficiency. And if somebody says that there is no inefficiency, you are nowhere in the picture, right? But I always say that I'll be still in the picture, because my approach is econometric. And if there is no inefficiency, it's a standard neoclassical production function approach. So I always say this is very difficult to kill me, because I wear two hats, right?
Your recent works, for example, include environmental analysis or eco-efficiency. Yeah. What variables do you use to analyzing eco-efficiency?
So again, you know, like in the standard approach, we do not take into account what we call, you know, either you can just say eco-efficiency, or we just say that bad output, okay? Or we distinguish between good output and bad output. So think of agriculture, because again, this university is mostly agriculture. So think in terms of sugarcane, okay? So what is happening is that in order to produce sugarcane, okay, you use usual thing, you have land, you have, you know, okay. But again, another component is pesticide, right? And nowadays, use of pesticide is becoming more common, and again, it's very much increasing. So what is happening, you get more output because again, bugs and other things are controlled, right? So that's increasing your output. And again, you are looking at the value of output or how much sugar cane you are producing. So again, you can see that while your productivity is going up, right? But then what you are not including is what is the side effect of all the pesticides, right? So that's basically again an input, because again, it's increasing your output, but again, it's polluting the water or again, like environment in some way. So another example is that, think of generating electricity, right? So generation of electricity, again, you know, like from coal, right? Why in many countries, again, like they are now relying less and less on coal because of the fact that, again, the side effect, right? So it's polluting the environment. So the question in there that is that, okay, somehow we need to take into account the good output, okay, which is electricity, and the bad output, which is the pollution. So in the case of sugarcane, the good output is the amount of sugarcane you produce, bad output is the contamination of the water, the runoff, you know, that is going to the river or underground water. So somehow we have to take into account. So in the past studies, we were ignoring it. So nowadays we are trying to focus on that aspect also.
If a student would like to include, for example, or would like to decomposition of productivity and including eco-environmental or eco-efficiency analysis. What hint do you give to this person or this student?
Okay, so then I have to ask him or her that in order to do so, like if you're looking at the sugar cane example, then I say that you need to get an idea or some data about the negative output or the bad output. That means what is, okay, how much is the the runoff or what type of again this is chemical component, right? So I'm not good in those chemistry. That means what are those chemical components that is coming out from the pesticide? Okay, so maybe that if I go back to the electricity example, so the pollution. Okay, so again there are different measures of pollution, right? So the question is that you have to get data, information about how much pollution is generated, right? So it's not only how much electricity they are producing, but how much pollution is generated. And that depends on also the type of coal, the quality of coal and things like that, right? So if you get a finer quality of coal, then the pollution is going to be less. So that type of, that means you need to get the information about this bad things that is coming out from the production.
Change the topic. For example, do you have another subject with your studies, like the relationship between corruption and economic growth? What you can say about this relationship and look to case of Brazil, for example, the car wash operation in the case of corruption in Brazil?
Okay, so that's also very interesting thing because I come from India, and again, like you know that corruption in India is rampant and like a very widespread. So again, like I started working with a PhD student, which we were discussing this issue that again, looking at the growth of different countries. Okay, so usually again, if you look at the read the papers, then the people will say that okay, growth of the country depends on again several things, right? So how much resources you have, again, quality of education of the workers and things like that, right? But then you always said that, okay, then I just said, okay, given all these things, it also depends on, again, how corrupt the country is, right? So if you think in terms of two countries, exactly they have same level of education for the workers, you know, okay, and the other things that you want to control, but one country is more corrupt than the other, right? So the question is that corruption should affect economic growth in some way. So if you look at the literature, there are some studies, they found that corruption helps economic growth, right? Okay, and there are some other studies which found that corruption reduce economic growth, right? So one, they said that, well, it stands the wheel, meaning it reduces the economic growth. And the other one said that, well, it basically lubricates the wheel. That means it makes it go faster. So again, they explain it in different ways, you know, why it can reduce the growth. Now, in some countries, again, I know that it is probably true to some extent in Brazil, but I don't know much about it. But think in terms of Bangladesh and some part of India, the salary of the people meaning that working in the public sector, so you know, so low that again, like they cannot meet their ends with that type of salary, right? So what they do is they, you know, it's kind of a subsidy, right? That means they get the bribe so that you know they can have a standard of living that they can maintain. So the question is then, how does it help economic growth, right? So when you get bribe, you know, you always spend the money, right? Maybe just you get a bribe from someone, you just take your family to a good restaurant, all right? So you're spending the money. And you know that in economics, spending the money is that means the restaurant owners get it. And then again, it's distributed to the employer. They go and then again start shopping, right? So again, like it helps. So the economy start growing, right? So this is the part that says that, well, it helps the economy to grow.
You teach in econometrics at State University of New York. For some students, is the terrible subject to study, but it's the most important nowadays. What hint or what topics do you analyze specifically with econometrics? And if you can give a hint for your students, what you say?
Okay, so for doing research, we usually, or I usually don't give them a topic. So they figure out their own topic. But nowadays, because of the internet, even before they come to the university to study, they know everything, right?
Yeah.
So again, as I was telling somebody that if you can spell my last name correctly, you'll find me in the internet. Because again, I am the only person with that last name who is an economist, okay? So they found out again what type of work that I do, and then sometimes they said, okay, they want to come to the State University of New York to work with me, and then they have some ideas to work on. And again, I always say that, well, this education or knowledge is something, there is a saying in Sanskrit in India, that, you know, like if you have knowledge and you give it, it increases it, unlike money, right? If you spend the money, you have less. But with education or knowledge, if you spread it, if you give it more and more, it increases, right? So now I believe in that. That means whatever I learned, you know, like I should distribute it and give it away to other people, right? And I don't have to be holding on to it, because if I hold on to it, again, there's no one else who will learn what I have done.
Thank you very much for this interview, Kumbhakar. It's an honor to me because I'm a student of economics and study your book. Thank you very much.
Okay, welcome.
Valeu, pessoal!